Hello, malty. Musty, mushy, mash masters. And thank you to Mark Van Vranken for that malt mention. And Mark is one of my pat pals. And a pat pal is a patreon.com subscriber. Someone who buys Ralphy a dram and gets the extra videos. So thank you, Mark. You have now had your malt mentioned. Right, this is Ralphy Review. 847. I better mark that down so as I don't get confused and repeat it. Confusion has been known in the past. However, there's no confusion as regards the quality of this particular single malt. Oh my goodness. Now, I know a few of you malt mates out there in the multiverse have been anticipating this for a while, because there is a debate at the moment about the extent to which GlenDronach has changed and morphed as a single malt core range over the last few years since it's changed ownership after this quite spectacular arrival, courtesy of the entrepreneur, the whiskey maverick, Billy Walker. There it is, there is the bottle. I'm holding it just sufficiently far away, and I'm going to tip it at the right angle so it's in focus and you don't see it with glare. There we are. I think I'm getting the hang of this. Essential information for your points of reference before you go out and buy a bottle. This is bottled at 46%. It claims it's matured in the finest Oloroso sherry casks from Spain. Well, you only get Oloroso sherry casks from Spain anyway. And they always say it's the finest, even if it's the not. They do go on to say, bottled by the proprietors, right to an official bottling. Well, that's kind of pretty self-evident. 18 years old. Good. That's useful information. It gives us a very, very important point of reference in the age statement. Now we can understand, because of the age statement, we can understand how the influence has been between the cask, the wood, and the contents. Some information is better than nothing. Anything else it says? Appearance, antique bronze. I ask you, antique bronze? If you look at antique bronze, they're all covered in age and patina. So it's just a bit of flannel. Antique bronze, for goodness sake, with an amber hue. There you go. How original. Intensely aromatic in the nose. Sip remarkable flavours of stewed fruits. That doesn't sound particularly appetising. Well, I read the whole thing. I'm going to do this. This is going to be a laugh. I'm going to try and do this without laughing. But I know I'm being snooty and snobby, but hey, I bought the bottle. You know, I paid the money for this, so I can do that. But honestly, there's folk out there, they will read the tasting notes. And the reason tasting notes are there on many bottles of single malt is just to help people understand generally, vaguely, what they're tasting. Because a lot of people, unlike you and I, malt mates, who have plenty of experience with a wide variety of spirits, many people have quite a limited experience, and it can be very confusing in the palate, particularly when the palate is centred on the Western diet, which is primarily about food for entertainment and satisfaction rather than for nutrition, where due to processing and the huge addition of sugar and salt and cheap ingredients, much of the flavour of the Western diet is actually processed out. You'll find this when you buy frozen pizzas and other ready meals. And because this has happened since childhood, and you'll notice kids, as soon as they're no longer taking breast milk, they will big fed rusks and mushed up cereal and fruit pulp from baby food. Now, the amount of sugar in that is truly shocking. And what happens is it desensitizes the palate. The overexposure to one sensation of sweetness, whether through sugar or artificial sweeteners or other sources of sweeteners, it dulls the palate. So when people grow up, sort of, they come to something which has got an array of sensations in different proportions and a lot of flavour ranges and morphing flavours, and it becomes really confusing. It needs experience, and I suppose the benefit is for those who are tasting for the first time, they've got some sort of guidance from the distillery. But I'm going to read it out now, because this is opening up, by the way. I poured it just before we started the video, so it's getting a bit of an oxygenation going. So appearance, antique bronze with an amber hue. Right. Dark brown. Do I think there's caramel in that? I think there was caramel into the casks when it was prepared. A form of caramel, perhaps jus or bois. Or basically boiled grape. It's called, what's the name? A rope. That's what it is. So that's added, it's natural colour because it's coming from the cask, but it's kind of a form of E150A that was put into the cask. A lot of the other colours are coming from tannins that comes through, particularly through American oak, depending on where it's sourced. Nose, intensely aromatic with dark treacle, raisin fudge and muscovado sugar in a morello cherry and baked orange fruitcake. Okay, so sherry, sweet and fruity. Palate, sip remarkable flavours of stewed fruits, orange peel and baked sultana bread, bound by robust allspice, cigar box and leather. Ooh, the taste of cigar box. This is why you should always lick your cigar boxes. You see, what they're saying in the flavour notes in the palate is you're going to taste something that you only ever smell. And a few folk may smell, because not many people buy cigars these days. So it's suggested. And this suggestion by, it's very, very powerful, beware of it. Because you'll find if you're in company and someone is starting, I've been guilty of this myself in tastings, where I've told people what I'm tasting, and it's very leading, and frankly, I'm stopping doing that, because it's not misdirection or anything, it's just overly controlling. The singular and individual experience of taste belongs exclusively to the drinker. There you go. Now we've got the finish. Savour caramelised walnut, treacle, that's the treacle again, and date oil into the exceedingly long and full-bodied finish. Oh, this sounds very, very tempting. They never mention the bad bits. But you probably already know that. This has got to be one of the best value and most impressive sherry monster single malts on the market at the moment. I may as well forewarn you, because you do need to know this. Prices are going to go up. At the moment, they're already starting to creep up. Unfortunately, it won't help when I do this review. This will probably nudge prices up yet again. And therefore, I think before the shop owners see the review, you better get in there quick if you're planning to buy a bottle. And by the way, do your shopping. Do your shopping online. Do a price comparison. You're the customer. You earn that money. Spend it wisely. The cleanness and the freshness of this sherry style. I'll come back to this in a future video. Nose is second to none. It's beautifully clean. It reminds me of really good quality Glenfarclas, or even Aberlour. You know, those non-sulfated casks that are generally filled while they're relatively fresh. They've not been lying around in the warmth for too long and gone slightly sour, which absolutely impacts on flavour and leads to a certain acidity growing in some sherried single malts. This, clean as a whistle. The richness is, there's that kind of sweet and sour thing going on. The very tannin rich, but you can see that the sweetness of the cask preparation is certainly moderating that. These are, for contemporary whiskey casks, these are great, actually. They're as good and as solid as the old school casks from the 1960s. You do get slight treacle notes, but it's very, very modest on my nose. But you certainly get a certain fruit, date, definitely, and fig too as well. Date oil and oiliness, yeah, I'll go along with that. I concur with that diagnosis. Quite gentle and restrained, you know there's more in it. And you know you're going to get more off the taste than the nose. Changes significantly once you add water. But we'll have a sip, a raw sip at the moment. 46% certainly helps. Is it chill filtered with caramel added? Quite possibly. Because if it doesn't say it isn't, you've got to presume it is. Oh, sharp. Sharp and nippy on the palate. Bit of a shock, a sting of almost sherry vinegar, balsamic. It's sweetened, but you can't get away from it. The first impression is not that impressive. And the simple reason is, this is a kind of concentrated, it's like single malt cordial. You'd notice more variety at 40%, but at 46%, we add the water at point of need, and therefore we get far more dynamic activity as a result of it opening up over the space of the next half hour. I'm going to add a full 5 milliliters, 1 teaspoonful, standard international measure of water into this whiskey. Some gentle stroly-poly, nothing too shaky-shaky. Oh, I hate it when see people shaking their glass about. It's just a bad habit. A sign of impatience. As soon as you bring your nose back, you're getting more out of it. You're getting more, there's banana, baked banana in there. You're getting those fruitcake notes. The sultana, most certainly. Soft toffee, muscovado, absolutely. It's kind of reminiscent of a few old Jamaican rums. You know, the really old ones, about 30 years. They kind of has that same character, but it's more expressive. It tends to change its range of flavours a little bit faster than you'd get with the old rums. In fact, to be honest, see any rum over 15 years from the Caribbean, it's probably overaged. Beware of that. Settling down, this little bit of the cask is now coming through. Good quality oak. Spice, that old spice is coming through. And a little bit of toffee, gentle, soft toffee notes, natural. I'm looking for the aromatic signature of the GlenDronach stills, but it's really not there yet. For a good 15 minutes, it's going to be the casks that really dominate and control the whole event of smell, both smell and taste. So, like so many malts at this age, the slower you go, the further you get. Simple as that. Taste. The harsh balsamic nip has gone, literally within a few minutes. You have so much more balanced, much more expressive and singular sweet and sour going on. Sweetness from the cask and a little bit of sourness coming from the spirit, from the GlenDronach spirit. They're now balancing off really, really neatly. They're not sort of opening up at the moment. They're beginning to open up. Coming back to it, smell and taste. I'll start with the arrival. Tiny, tiny taste. Really interesting savoury note, umami note coming from that these casks. The sweetness, once it recedes, it kind of rolls back like a wave on the sandy shore, and you see the sandy surface of what is in fact quite a sour, slight sourwood note coming from the casks, which translates as savoury. The tannins most certainly contribute to this, because there are a lot of tannins in this. The tannins have weathered and mellowed significantly over these 18 years. This has been very well warehoused, and it shows the development. And this is where the dram is now coming. It's hitting its stride. It's coming into its bliss point. Every whiskey at every age has a different bliss point, depending how much water you add and how much time you give it, and it helps you to find that bliss point, the perfect pitch of the event, particularly in your palate but also in the nose, when you have an age statement as a point of reference. This is another reason for age statements. Pineapple oil, banana, allspice, mixed spice, hint of clove in the background, wintergreen, bitter wintergreen, a touch of the absinthe, gentian, that's what it is. Along with wormwood and absinthe, you often get gentian, particularly the good quality ones. So you're getting that delicious sour and slight bitterness. It's confident, and it's balancing off, so you're getting a real wonderful range of the sensations here. Sweet, sour, bitter, less of the salt. The savour, it's more savoury than salt, although you may find little hints of saltiness in with the umami savoury notes that are being imposed by a really good balance between the casks and the spirit. Finish, got to finish somewhere. The volume of the event is just continuing to grow, displaying the quality of the casks. It's so well mannered, but it's still got a bit of youthfulness about it. Still got that energy that you get in younger single malts, but also with the growing maturity and characteristics of an old whiskey, which is where they come in with their cigar boxes. And what else was it they had? What was these two suggestive notes? Cigar boxes and leather. Yeah, leather's a common one. Sometimes when they talk about leather, they in fact mean shoe polish or dubbin, which is a sort of wax-based paste that you put in shoes. And it has a little linseed note in it, and beeswax note. So that can often be put in with leather descriptors. But you often find it in conjunction with quite tannic sherry casks, particularly Oloroso. So, what a fantastic whiskey. The finish, it's got these suggestive notes that you're tasting something that you've not tasted, but you've smelt before. So we should always take the time to smell, use our noses. We should all have our doggy mode. Although we're not smelling absolutely everything, you understand. Only the nice things. Having said that, if you smell the nasty things, it gives you a fantastic point of reference. Before I go any further, why don't I just give this a malt mark? Or one more sip. Just one more. I'll be with you in a minute. So much longer in the development. Lovely eau de vie notes. Eau de vie de poivre. Pear spirit, French. Clean, fresh, honest. Wonderful stuff. I'm going to give this... I had a wee run of good marks recently. I'm going to give this 90 out of 100. And the right reason for 90 is it's down to the quality of the casks. It's the first thing, particularly with sherried whiskies these days, the first thing I'm looking to taste is actually how good are the casks, because they're just going to be the decider whether I like this or not. These are excellent casks. And in fact, what I could conclude by saying, some you might consider it kind of controversial, but having recently reviewed the new 15-year-old Revival under the new ownership of the distillery, it's a very good single malt, but it's not the same as the original. They're just different casks, and it shows, and they declare it. It's not the same, and people really have it in the mindset now, oh, it was that 15-year-old Revival that just popped up in the scene suddenly without any sort of fanfare and big marketing tub thumping, and it was just such good whiskey that nobody could miss it, and everybody was buying it, and it became the standard affordable benchmark go-to single malt for people who love the sherry monsters. That's what the 15-year Revival was. In my opinion, this is the new 15-year-old Revival. It's called the Allardyce now. It's the 3 years older. This is definitely a good step up from the 15-year-old, whereas a few years ago, the 15-year-old was better than the 18-year-old. And that's the way whiskey goes. That's just the way it happens. I'm Ralphie, I'm all done and dusted. Pop back shortly, if you don't mind, for my extras, where I'll be discussing one of the tricks for getting access and understanding a whiskey that a little bit further. And I'll also include one of the little novelties that brand ambassadors and whiskey makers do when they're doing public presentations, and everybody's slightly shocked. It's almost as shocking as when you see master distiller Richard Patterson swirl out his finest Dalmore and smack it down onto the carpet. And I was going to say something bitchy there, but I'm not. I'm going to be a gentleman about it, because there are good Dalmores out there. But I tell you what, there's other Dalmores where the carpet's welcome to it. Anyway, join me shortly for Ralphy Review 847 Extras. I shall now lift up the Clivey kicker and clicker. And even before I go anywhere near that button, I'm just going to say cheerio, malt mates. Enjoy your drams, take your time, and keep it quality, not quantity. Oh, the boost didn't work. What? I'll be more positive this time. 3, 2, 1.